Good afternoon, everyone. You all get A's for getting here on time. Our iPhones fortunately update for us now, which is great. But I'm absolutely thrilled that you're all here. My name is Julia Dolan. I'm the Minor White Curator of Photography, and I am co-curator of the exhibition, Contemporary Native Photographers and the Edward Curtis Legacy. I'm co-curating along with curator of Native American art, Dina Dart. And I'm absolutely thrilled to have you here today and to welcome you to the Portland Art Museum on our first artist talk relating to this exhibition. As a very quick reminder, exactly 1 week from now, right here, Zig Jackson will be speaking about his work. And Will Wilson will be here on April 9th and 10th to talk about his work and do some photographic work for us as well. So we're incredibly lucky to have all three participating artists here to talk about their work and this exhibition. Zig will be traveling in from Savannah, Georgia, and Will is coming in from Santa Fe, New Mexico. But we as a community are so incredibly fortunate to have Wendy Red Star living right here in Portland, along with her daughter, Beatrice. So we get to enjoy her all the time. Originally from Montana, Wendy holds a BFA in sculpture from Montana State University, Bozeman, and an MFA in sculpture from UCLA. And I would like to let you all know, even though the exhibition is called Contemporary Native Photographers and the Edward Curtis Legacy, Wendy is a multimedia artist, but it's hard to fit that many words in a title. Takes up a little too much room on the side of the building, so for this she allowed us to go ahead and refer to her as a photographer, but luckily for me as a photo curator, she employs a lot of photography in her work. Wendy is an internationally exhibited artist who bluntly, beautifully, and with exceptional humor addresses issues of Native American identity as well as gender and contemporary life. She has had solo exhibitions here at the Portland Art Museum, as well as the St. Louis Art Museum, the Indianapolis Museum of Contemporary Art, and even the Seattle Art Fair, among many others. Her work has been included in group exhibitions at New York's Metropolitan Museum of Art, perhaps you have heard of it, the Peabody Essex Museum in Salem, Massachusetts, the National Museum of the American Indian in New York City, the Nelson Atkins Museum in Kansas City, the Museum of Contemporary Native Arts in Santa Fe, and that's just in the United States. Her work has also been on exhibition in Montreal, Calgary, many locations in British Columbia, including Vancouver, in Paris, France, and in Skien, Norway as well. Wendy is a sought-after speaker and is the recipient of many notable awards, including the Joan Mitchell Foundation Emerging Artist Grant Program Fellowship, the Golden Spot Award and a residency from Crow's Shadow Institute of the Arts, the Idle Jorg Contemporary Art Fellowship, and she held a residency at the Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture in Maine. On a personal note, I was really lucky to spend a lot of time with Wendy as we were installing the exhibition. Wendy's work is site-specific. She created all of this work for us as viewers for this exhibition, and we've been working with her for a year so that she could come up with the ideas and the responses that she thought were most important. So I was able to spend a good 6 or 7 days in the galleries with her, and I am so glad that I had that time to learn about her family, and really get to know her in a way. That's one of the special things about being a curator, is learning about these wonderful artists who work among us and show us things that we really need to see. So please join me in welcoming Wendy Red Star.
Technology. It's my fault because there's like a million photos that I included, so. Thank you.
to go change something in the back.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to stall, but I wanted to say thank you for coming. I know, like, the time change. I totally forgot about it. Usually my mother calls me, but for some reason she didn't. But luckily, like Julia said, the phones have updated. But I want to say first thank you to the Portland Art Museum. The Portland Art Museum has been really instrumental in supporting me in my art career. I had a solo exhibition in 2014 with Bonnie Lang Malcolmson, and then continuing on, there's a few pieces that are in the collection as well, and with this exhibition, and I really want to thank Julia. It's been a complete pleasure to work with you, to talk photo with you, and also Dina Dart, who also helped co-curate. Keep going. Yes.
Okay, sweet.
Okay. So I just want to say thank you so much. I've been living in Portland for about 8 years. I left in 2012 and 2013, went back to my reservation, which is in Montana. It's the Crow Indian Reservation. And I ran Chief Planicou State Park. And Chief Planicou was our last official primary chief of the Crow tribe. And he donated his allotted land to the state of Montana so people could come to the Crow Reservation and learn about Crow culture from Crow people in that environment. And so it was really wonderful to have that experience. My dad lives about 5 miles away from that park, so I grew up seeing it. But ever since I came back to Portland in 2013, it's just been tremendous support from Portland, so I'm just truly honored. And I'll go ahead and get started. So I'm gonna spend about half of my time going really fast, and we're gonna go down memory lane. I'm gonna show you almost all of my work. But I'm gonna go fast, and I wanna spend real quality time talking about contemporary Native photographers and the Edward Curtis legacy and what I did towards the end. So bear with me if I'm kind of cruising here, but like I said, it's sort of like an Olympic marathon with the images. So I wanted to start first with early work when I was going to undergrad at Montana State University in Bozeman. So early work, I started as a graphic designer. I had to take foundations courses, and the sculpture professor was like, look, you need to change your major. Because obviously, look at this, right? So this is a self-portrait of me, but it's my parents, my mother, who is Irish, of Irish descent, and my father, who is Crow, and that's a mold of my teeth. I was really getting, you know how you are in undergrad. You're all about feelings and therapy and stuff, so. But again, the thing that, this is a very pivotal piece for me that I did in undergrad, which really has set the tone for my practice. And I like to say that I'm a research-based artist. And so it all started with taking Native American studies classes. And here's a map of Montana and the tribal territories of Montana pre-contact and then through colonization. So right here is Crow country down here. And you can see we've got Blackfeet and Grovon, Assiniboine, Hidatsa, Mandan, and Arikara, which are over in North Dakota region. We've got Kootenai, Salish Kootenai. And then you can see Crow territory right here is 38 million acres. Northern Cheyennes are here. This is their current reservation. This is our current reservation, which is 2.5 million acres. And so what happened is I was studying more about Crow culture, and I found this guy, amazing chief, one of my favorite chiefs. His name is Chief Sits in the Middle of the Land. And he was, during the Fort Laramie Treaty, it was our original territory treaty with the United States. And they asked him to provide what our territory was. And what he did was he gave a statement about our four teepee poles, the foundation of our teepee. We set four poles up and then we lay the rest of them down. And with that, he put a pole on each corner, and he mapped out 38 million acres with that pole, saying one rests at this point, one rests at this point. And what that mapped out was our migration route throughout the seasons. And he said, my home is where my teepee sits. And that just blew me away. And so when I looked closer, I realized that Bozeman, where I was going to undergrad, was in Crow Country. So I called up my dad, like I do all the time still, and I said, look, I gotta tell these people they're on Crow Country. You know? So I harvested a bunch of lodgepoles on our reservation, and he helped me rig up the truck, and I brought them to campus, and I set up these teepee installations. And first I started out with showing how you put up a teepee. So here's the four poles. This is the rest of the poles on the foundation. Oops. And then with the cover. And then from there on, I scouted out different territory on campus. I looked to see where students crossed the most, and I would put it right on their pathways. And I would let it sit there for maybe a few days, and then I would switch and find a different place. And then I kind of, this is where it got interesting, co-ed dorms, men and women cohabitating together. And this is when I would set up, I'd spend like 8 hours setting up these teepees, and sometimes my mom would come and help me, or I'd get a friend. And the poles are about 30 feet long. So they're really weird once you lift them up. They're kind of wobbly, stuff like that. So I'd spend all day. The next day I came and the poles were totally knocked down. Here's another view. So then I started like getting really mad. And I started making these like fortresses. It would take me all day, and I was just piling lodge poles on. It wasn't even like looking like a teepee. And I was like, take that, you know? And by the time I was like, people were saying, why don't you spend the night and see who it is? And I'm like, I was way too tired, so I'd have to go home. And they'd be knocked down. So then I was like, well, screw it. I'm just gonna put it on the football field. And that's how I ended my graduate career there at Montana State University, undergrad. UCLA. So I was really into horseback riding. That was what life was for me, was just riding horses. And I took my horses to Montana State University. I rode dressage. So my goal was to be the first Native American dressage Olympian. And we do, I think we have a Deborah Butterfield sculpture here. So she has her barn in Bozeman. So I used to ride her horses and do all of that. And I told my, you know, the goal was, I get through undergrad, then I just start riding horses again. And my mom was like, no, you need to apply to graduate school. So I just applied to all the, I like Googled, it's like top sculpture programs in the US, in UCLA, Yale, Chicago Institute, CalArts, Virginia Commonwealth all came up. So I just applied to all of them because I was like, I'm not going to get in, right? Then I can ride horses. And I ended up getting into all of them except two. And UCLA was the fit for me. And it was an incredible experience. And that's when I was housed with about, I think, 40 other graduate students, all in one building doing different mediums. I came under sculpture, but I got really obsessed with the photography people. And the photography people are weird, right? So you have like photo people that have their studios that they just vacuum like every week, and they keep the walls really white. Then you had photo people who were all about thumbprints on their photos and like cutting them up. And then you had people who would like print for prints that would look good in this light and light over there, and they just seemed like super neurotic and strange. But I liked it, and I liked what they were doing. So then I started doing a lot of photos. So this is what I did at UCLA. I set up my own portrait shots based on historical images. reality TV was like huge, so I made my own Res Housewife. And this was really fun because in LA you can go to prop shops and you can rent stuff. So I was renting miniature couches. And then it kind of kept going into doing more and more elaborate sets. And this is a piece I did around Thanksgiving. I wasn't able to go back home to my reservation. So this is based on The Last Supper. I call it The Last Thanks. And then the most incredible thing happened to me. I made The Four Seasons. And I can't tell you what a door opener that has been for me. And it all started, I went to the Natural History Museum. Again, my work, I was thinking, I was longing for home in a very sick and dark way. And I think all natives know this, is if you go to a natural history museum, you will find stuff on your people. And I did. And the way that it was set up at the Natural History Museum in LA is you have to walk through the dinosaur exhibit to get to the Native American exhibit. So I walked past the dinosaur bones, and then, ta-da, there was crow moccasins. And I was thinking, well, this is so bizarre, because these people are looking at all of these objects like Native people don't exist, and I have my entire outfit in my closet. So that really resonated with me, and I wanted to build diorama sets, because there's also some really great dioramas in there to convey that kind of feeling that I was having. So I made The Four Seasons. I spent a lot of time at Michael's and getting flowers and backdrops, 70s photo mural backdrops from eBay, and online hunting stores to get animal decoys, and I'm still obsessed with that, still doing lots of work with animal decoys. But one of the crazy things that happened to me is I had a critique at UCLA, and I just set up one of the backdrops. I think it was either this one or Indian Summer, and I got the harshest critique. There was this guy in there, and we had a falling out, and we like absolutely hated each other, and he was in my critique seminar. And then the instructor was like this abstract painter who just painted in black and white, so he's really hated that I did color. And so like those two kind of going at it with me, and they're like, this will never exhibit, Wendy. This will never exhibit. And I remember going out to the parking lot. I was like, I'm not going to cry. No one at graduate school will see me cry, because there's a whole thing, you go to graduate school and you have to cry or something. So I did, I cried, and I like called up my dad, and like he said some kind of joke and made me laugh. And then fast forward, like just last year, this showed at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. So I was like, and I did a lecture at Cal Arts. I know it's not UCLA, but I wanted to talk to those students and tell them the story, because I know that they're, you know, having a hard time in their studio, different people coming in and out and giving them opinions, but just to, you know, stick with it and keep going. So that was really, really wonderful. So here's where things get really strange, post-grad work. 2006 to 2016, that's a lot to cover, so I'm gonna try to go fast. So again, I understand why people say that I do photography, because I work with images all the time. So for this piece, it's the Fancy Shawl Project, and it showed at the Eideljorg in Indianapolis. And what I did was I documented common things you'd see on any town in my reservation. So there was houses, dogs, basketball hoops, sweat lodges, and cars. And I put them on these fancy shawl outfits, and fancy shawl is a dance, popular dance that girls do at powwows, and I have a video, hopefully it works. And what I said to the Eideljorg is I wanted to celebrate my reservation for what I know it to be, not like these things that normally people would associate with Native Americans, like horses and beads and fringe, and, well, I guess there's fringe on there, but like normal things, right? But really to show the beauty of that. So here's the basketball hoop. Basketball's huge in Indian country. All the broken down res cars. Res dogs. And historically, reading about Crow people, we had a lot of dogs. We did not eat our dogs. So that's why we probably had a lot of dogs. Sweat lodges are like our way to do like a sauna. A lot of people will have sweat lodges in their backyards. And then I worked with the Chamawa Indian Schools, the oldest functioning Indian boarding school in the US. And I worked with five girls there to make outfits and have them dance. So I'll play a little bit of this. And then that ended up playing with the shawls hanging in the background at the Idoljorg. Here's another body of work. So I kind of transitioned from kind of doing these sets, building these sets, to then moving into kind of fiber-based things. All the images on the shawls were printed on fabric. And then that kind of moved into doing more fiber-based things. And what I wanted to create with this series is called Thunder Up Above series. And it's about if we are, I think of outer space as the final frontier, and if we are to find life out there, that those are the indigenous people of that land, and we're probably going to colonize them. So I wanted to show who those beings are. So these are my indigenous people of the final frontier. And the outfits are based on mashups of powwow outfits. Colors are a little bit different. Oh, and people always ask me, so they're like, oh, so how'd you get those backgrounds, or what's your process? Well, this is my process. I just take a picture in my bedroom. You know, like, I'm totally a weirdo in my bedroom with a self timer going on. And then it looks like that. So the photographs display and the outfits display, and I'm really pleased the Portland Art Museum now owns two of these outfits, a gold jingle dress and the star quilt, and the other outfits are also in different museum homes, so that's been really great. And I think you guys have seen this one. This next body of work is something that I grew up seeing all the time on my reservation, and it's Crow clowns. And I was trying to figure out the history of this, and I started reading some more historical books, turn of the century, and there's documentation of clowns. And clowns will show up anytime there's a large gathering of crows, meetings or something. And if they sense any tension, they'll come out of the bushes or something dressed really hideous. They dress like old people. Not that old people are hideous, but the crow clowns. And they'll even like bring horses and throw mud all over their horse. And then they'll just sort of make these jokes. And then the crowd will try to egg them on or try to pull off their masks or something. And then through like colonization and stuff and Halloween, the crow clowns are now associated with Halloween, and they do this masquerade thing. And it's a lot of like young crows, again, dressing like the elders. And it gets really elaborate. And originally, they would have these dances just to crow music. Now it's like Michael Jackson with crow music, all sorts of stuff. And again, it's a competition, and the people who lose get demasked, and it can be really exciting because there can be a very ultra, maybe Republican or conservative person who is, you just saw, like, doing some crazy stuff to Michael Jackson. So it's really fun. So I went and I documented one of the masquerades and took portraits of some of the dancers. So, but before I get to that, this is two of my uncles, my Uncle Clive and my Uncle Aaron, going to a masquerade. And like I said, it gets really elaborate. So their whole plan was that they were a married couple who was having a fight that night. So they would go and fight each other and then dance with other people, that kind of thing. So here's one of those at the masquerade. And the thing, it's really thrilling for the crowd because you are not safe. They will try to pull you out onto the dance floor. And so this is the winner. And every time this guy shows up and everybody knows it's him, even though he's disguised, his name's Chris Parrish. And I don't know if you follow anything in Indian country, but he's a rapper, and his name is Superman. So this is Superman, but it's just really unfair because he can do backflips and moonwalk, and everyone just pretty much gives up. So here's a little bit of a clip of him, some of the masquerade. This is to crow music.
You're being judged, dancers. You're being judged.
Hey! I just think that is so incredible that that happens in Crow Country. That's what we do. Again, working with fiber, and again, working with old photographs. And I think this really kind of fits in. Again, I think I was having like a frustrating time seeing works like Edward Curtis being highlighted as this precious and authentic Native person when I would flip through my family photographs and seeing like my grandma or my dad and seeing them as what I know to be a Crow. So I wanted to make those images precious. So this was sort of born again, printing photos on fabric. And here's a detail. And this one is called Two Prom Dates because my dad had two prom dates. Yeah. This is Blue Creek Road. Again, I really like this image that I found, and I have to apologize for the quality of image that I show, but it's just my grandma with all my aunties, some of my cousins, and they just stopped over and took a family portrait. So I just got a Wikipedia page. I'm super excited. And what I love is in the biography, they talk about my dad being a pilot. I think he's one of the only Crow Indian pilots, but they also mention that he's in this band called the Maniacs. And what I love about it is all Indian, all Crow Indian rock band, and one of his groupies came up to me like maybe 6 years ago, and she's like, oh my God, your dad, you know, the white people had the Beatles and the Crows had the Maniacs. There's the Maniacs. Again, pictures of my aunts and uncles. And then I started just archiving stuff that I would see signage on the reservation, stuff that you could totally see the effects of colonization and kind of also how Crows were then Crowanizing things. So you can see with the First Baptist Church, you can see how they've put a Crow border around that, or welcome to Crow Country, entering the Crow Indian lands, non-tribal members restricted to paved roads. So just remember, stay on the paved roads. Different sweat lodges that you'd see. The churches, again, for Native people, probably the first contacts were always religious entities. So these were some of the first churches. The res cars. This is a collaboration I did with Terrence Houle, and I'm proud to say that the Portland Art Museum now owns the dress. And we were focusing on resources and oil. We both come from kind of oil places. Me in Montana, my tribe does a lot of coal, and he lives in Calgary, and he's Blackfoot. And we wanted to talk about resources and how we're dependent on oil and things now as a people. And before, our resources were buffalo, and that got destroyed. And so we made the buffalo and this plain-style dress out of petroleum-based product, vinyl. And this will actually be showing with the buffalo and the Native Fashion Now exhibit, which I believe opens in June. Is that correct? And I believe you guys might have seen it on display. This next body of work, I was researching the term squaw, which is a derogatory term towards Native women. It comes from the fur trapping era. And you know how it is when you do Google search, you just kind of spend like a whole day after you're like looking things up. And so I looked up the term squaw, and I kept going further and further, and then I found white squaw. I was like, well, what's a white squaw? And it turns out there was a movie in 1950 called White Squaw, and from that, there was a book that came out in the 80s, and that's what freaked me out. I was like, this came out in the 80s. So there's a whole book series of 24 books. It's sort of like a pulp fiction book called White Squaw, and I got really obsessed with it. Number one, it was like really derogatory and horrible towards women. And I picked it up, and the main character, you can see her in the middle, and you can all kind of see her in the bottom. Her name's Becky. And I can't figure out what Becky is, because she'll be a Navajo in one book. Apparently, she's Sioux in this book. But she's also half white, and I'm also half white. So I was like, well, I think I can do a way better job than Becky. So I purchased all 24 books, and then I scanned them in, and I kept everything of the original book, but I just got rid of Big Becky. And so this one is Sue Wildflower. It's number one. She takes men in hand in trouble and stride. And this is my rendition. This is a number nine, Twin Peaks or Bust. Hard pressed for revenge, she knows all the right moves. Yes, yes, I do. Yes, I do. This is number 24. Her twin guns cocked. She comes down hard on a gang of outlaws, fixin' to excite an uprising. Yes. This piece, for me, it was a way to own that word and gain some empowerment. It's also, I'm glad I could get some humor out of it. But it was really important for me that it not just go to a private collector, and it ended up going, it's now currently in the Triton Museum collection, so I'm really happy it's got a platform like that, that it can exist in. And this is the most recent work that I just did, had a solo show at Ha Contemporary. Tokens, Gold, and Glory, Parading Culture is what it's called. And again, I'm working with hunting decoys. I'm talking about trade system, commerce, and what is value to one culture versus another. And I'm hoping that Pendleton will please endorse me. So there's a photo series that came out of that as well. And some animals to parade. From 2014 to present, I've been collaborating with my 8-year-olds. And again, I would like to thank the Portland Art Museum, because this collaboration came out of an exhibition I did in the Apex Gallery called Medicine Crow and the 1880 Crow Peace Delegation. So this is Medicine Crow with 5 other Crow chiefs in Washington, D.C. in 1880. And what had happened is that his photo, a photo of Medicine Crow, they each took individual delegation portraits at that time, and this isn't one of the images, but he took a one that's forward-facing and one that's a little bit of a three-quarter, and that image had been totally, it's been and is still being mass-produced and put on books, and it's on Honest Tea. And I see other artists, both non and native artists, using this image. And I realized that they probably don't even, it would be great, maybe they know his name, but they probably don't even know he's Crow or anything, or let alone what happened when he sat down that day. So that's what that exhibition was about. And I discovered all this stuff about them traveling there because the government was gonna put the railroad through a large chunk of our territory, and also that they held them there for 30 days to get them homesick so they would sign. They took them to the zoo. And then they took these delegation portraits and they wore their finest outfits. And through that, I worked with researchers, and I knew about their outfits, I've seen them. But this was great because I got to break down things. Like, for instance, all this sort of white stuff here is ermine, and in order to wear ermine on your war shirt, you had to capture a gun. If you had ermine on your leggings, that meant that you stole a horse. And in order to be a Crow chief, you had to do 7 things, and they were really difficult things. In order to wear these hair bows that look really cute, right? He's got 2 of them. This one's actually broken. He had to overcome an enemy and slice their throat. So this is what he's telling you, even though he looks very stunning. you just don't want to mess with him. And also, he had a really sick sense of humor. There's a great story where he was traveling with a group of crows and to get horses back. Some other tribe had stolen some of our horses, and they passed an Indian agent, white Indian agent's home. And they spent the night there, and they went on. They ended up getting the horses back and killing a couple of the native people who stole the horses. And Medicine Crow was like, well, I want to play a joke on this agent when we return back and stay at his house. So he cut off one of the Indian guy's hands, and he carried it in his pocket. And when they reached the agent's house, he stuck it in his shirt sleeve, and he shook the agent's hand and backed up. And that's this guy's sense of humor, you know? So being at this point, I was working full time, a 40-hour a week job, and doing all this art stuff. And I have my 8-year-old. I have her, I'm a single parent, so I have her half time. And she, one day after work, she's like, well, wanted to engage with me, obviously. And I was like, I really have to get this done for the show, but I made all these Xerox copies. And I said, why don't you play with one of these? And then she came back to me, and this is what she did. And I was still trying to figure out how to close the show, and this was it. And I said, well, you've got to be in the show with me. So I printed off on better quality paper all of the chiefs and then set her up, and she just went to town. And she created this 20 portraits, and it was incredible. And then from there on, I've just continued to collaborate with her, and it's been really kind of easygoing, where I'll say, well, I'm doing this thing, and then she'll say, well, I want to do it too. And then I'll say, okay, well, let's figure out how you can do it. So it's never been a thing where I'm going to do this, and I'm going to insert my child in there. It's usually, it's always... she wants to be involved, and then we figure it out. So this is the rest of the Apex show. At the Seattle Art Museum, we made her own Four Seasons, and it was at a remix event. She helped me pick out the flowers and all of that stuff, and then we had people at the remix event. It's this big kind of event that Seattle has fairly often, where the public gets to come in, and they get to drink a lot, actually. I had no idea. But... there was a Native American exhibit that was on display, and unfortunately I'm blanking on the name. So anyways, we got the participants to take photos, and then that was projected before they went on to into the Native American exhibit, so they were on display before they saw the objects on display. And then we also went to the Tacoma Art Museum, and we did a performative piece where we... remade some of the Haub family collection. And actually, my Uncle Kevin is in there, so we kind of made fun of him. But we made everybody wear sunglasses, and then we had little props, and B would dress up like the paintings, and I would describe them. And that was a really fun project, and at the end, we took a group photo. So that's been a really fulfilling project. And then we still continue to work with the exhibition here. But before, you might have noticed that I've titled this lecture, Apsáalooke Feminist. And the piece that is outside on the museum wall and facade, and the one that's in the exhibit, is also from the Apsáalooke Feminist series. So you probably want to know what that is. And it originated, I'm on Instagram, and I wanted to create an art piece with my own hashtag. So originally it started out as hashtag Apsáalooke Feminist, and it documents everything that I do or things that I label as an Apsáalooke Feminist. So I'm still working out what that means, but here's a bunch of images that I think are Apsáalooke Feminist. And Apsáalooke is the crow word for crow. So these are not Edward Curtis photos, these are Richard Thrussell. And Richard Thrussell took photographs the same time as Edward Curtis of the Crow people, and the government had placed them on our reservation to document how Crow people were assimilating And he also documented tuberculosis because it was quite high. So I actually find his images way more interesting because it's showing exactly how the crows were dressing at that time and what they were doing. This is actually a portrait of my grandma, Amy Brightwings. Again, a picture of my grandma, Amy Brightwings. This is Crow Fair. It's a large event that we have every third weekend in August where we all camp. Every family camps and we have parades. I think elk tooth dresses are essential to be an Apsáalooke feminist. Here's a little bit of the process. Sped up, of course. And those are elk teeth, and there's only two eye teeth per elk. These are made out of resin, but historically, there have been dresses in collections that have upwards to 800 per side. It's very labor intensive, and this is Bee wearing that dress. This is Bee at age 8, and this is me at age 8 at Crow Fair, combined us together. This is me and my cousins at Crow Fair. This again is at Crow Fair. Is it gonna let me play? So this is Apsáalooke feminist. Don't mess with her. With that overview, really it's all about my background and culture, and it perfectly feeds into the contemporary Native photographers and the Edward Curtis legacy. And a lot of Native artists don't want to touch Edward Curtis because they feel like they'll be pigeonholed. And for me, I understand that. I get where they're coming from. I get where the problems are with Edward Curtis, and it's from his perspective, and any photographer taking pictures, it's from their individual perspective, no matter how honest they're trying to be. So for me, it was more an opportunity to have access to all the resources and all the stuff he did on my people. So he worked directly with the Crow tribe in 1908. And but before I get to that, I found these memes that I thought were kind of funny of Edward Curtis on Crow. This is one too, you know. This is my favorite though. It's true, he's not Native American. Come on, guys. So what was great was getting to see these books up close and personal. And this, I can't credit these hands. I can't remember. It was in the archives. Anyways, these are not my beautiful hands. So I worked directly with book number 4. And it was great to have access to look at these books. And then to see the portfolio images, all of which were just pictures of Crow men. And the writing also was heavily on Crow men. There was a small snippet, which I'll read you, that wasn't about Crow men. And this is a small snippet, and I'll have to turn this way. So this is what Edward Curtis thought of us. So he said, in stature and in vigor, the Absorca, so they used to call us Absorca, but it's Apsáalooke, or Crows, excelled all other tribes of the Rocky Mountain regions. Yes, Edward Curtis, I would agree. The rigors of this life made the women as strong as the men. Yes, yeah. And the women could carry a quarter of a buffalo, apparently without great exertion, ride all day and all night with a raiding war party, or travel afoot 250 miles across unmarked wilderness of mountains, plains, and swollen streams in 4 days and nights. Were not the women to bring forth puny offspring. So true.
They rarely allied themselves with other tribes for the purpose of defiance. For probably 2.5 centuries, they were the enemy of every tribe that came within striking distance. And for a goodly part of this time, they were virtually surrounded by hostile bands with a common hatred against this mountain tribe that likened itself to a pack of wolves. Everybody hates us, man. So true. It's so true. Like, I grew up knowing that everybody hates us. So that was something I wanted to include in the exhibit, but also all these books written about the crows. And do you know how strange it is to come from a culture, a studied people, to be a studied people? It's really weird. And even taking Beatrice to Powell's and let's go find some books on crow people. It's a weird thing. So I wanted to put all the books on crow people. But working with the portraits, I also wanted to really focus on women. So I told Julia, and I think, I don't know what she thought at the moment. She was really great in just letting me do what I wanted to do. But it's like, I'm just going to cut these guys out of the photo and give them a little bit of a rest because they've been mass produced so many times that it's time to give them a rest. But the thing is that Edward Curtis did these wax cylinder recordings of crow men, and they sing their honor songs and they sing death songs. And that's what's playing with this piece. So you don't get to see them, but you get to hear their voices. And to me, that's way more powerful than just seeing the image. The other important aspect was, like I told you, I worked at Chief Planicu State Park, and in his cabin home, he had this original allotment map. So I got a copy of it, and it was really important for me to place that map in the exhibition and give us all context of where each of these people come from. And this map was done in 1907, Curtis came in 1908, and all the names of the people that the photos give credit to are in here, including, see if you look right up here, here's Planicu's, and that's how they spelled it back then. But if you go down, you see here's Red Star. So that's where I got my last name, was from this map. When they put each head of household, they gave a chunk of land to, and my great-grandfather, Red Star, was one of those original allottees. So they used his name as our last names. So that's how we got most of our last names. And then, so our land is 1912. I'm sorry, where are we? Right there. That's where Red Star's allotment is on the map. Something kind of crazy, Julia sent me a text, and this is Julia's finger right there. So it says, Curtis actually ended up purchasing a tract of 120 acres from the Crow Reservation by some non-competence of a Crow allottee, number 2232. So I was like, who is this person that sold land to Curtis? And here, the name is Works, 2232. And then, where are you, 2232? Right here. So there's Curtis's little plot of land on the Crow Reservation. That's something that I didn't know, and I'd like to kind of go look at it. So this installation of doing the map took about 7 days to put up, and it was really cathartic. It was really wonderful to sit there and write these names. Here's a few of my favorite. But some of them are just so beautiful. Stands on a cloud and kills the half-breed. The other thing I wanted to include was I really wanted it to be more than just me and include other Native Apsáalooke feminists. So I reached out to all the Crow women I know on Facebook and asked them to send me pictures of them in elk tooth dresses, their mother, their children, their aunties, and I got about 50 images, and these are their images, and then I tried to put where their last names, their descendants are on the map. And they're printed on transparency paper, so you can still see behind them. And again, still focusing on women, I wanted to bring the color back because crows are all about being funny, as you could see, and then also lots of saturated color. So I took three images from the Edward Curtis book and erased their dress, and we created this project for the viewers to actually go in and empower those photos by giving them color. And then lastly, I wanted to do a modern portrait update of these turn-of-the-century photographs, but with me and Beatrice on our IKEA couch. And this is the Apsáalooke Feminist series. And we were so shocked when this was up on the building. I think we still are. And you can see there's Beatrice's face. So I'd like to end it there. Thank you. Thank you. So we have a few minutes for questions, and Stephanie has the microphone. If you could please use the microphone, I'll take maybe three or four questions. If there are any, I know I went through a lot of things. Yeah, right here.
Well, I'm wondering if you have any recordings.
Sorry. I'm wondering if you have any recording of, like, this presentation that you did today, because I'm sitting here thinking that I'd want my children to see what you just presented to us. Is it being recorded today?
Yes, it is.
Is it going to be available on the website, or?
Yes.
On the Portland Art Museum website? Beautiful. Thank you so much. It's wonderful.
Thank you. Is there any other questions? Oh, I guess way back there. Do you want to do that?
So. Yes.
I was wondering if you know what the reception of your work was like with like your community or crow communities?
So I love to always ask, because I get this question actually almost every lecture I do. What is the thinking behind that question when you ask me? I'm just curious, like, what prompts you to ask me that question?
Well, it kind of seems like your work comes out of like your experience like growing up and stuff, and I'm wondering like how other people who identify as crow like connect with that representation.
So it's kind of interesting. I think social media has been really great way for me, like I said, with this particular project to reach out to people or for crow people to see what I'm doing. And it's always been good, especially with this project. I really felt like it was total female empowerment, because they all were like, yes, I want to do this, and then they wanted to share it, and they were very excited, and so that was important to me. But the main thing I think I like with crow audiences is that they totally get everything without me having to explain anything. And then you have like the older generation, like my dad, who thinks I'm just kind of weird, but he's okay with it, you know? But I think social media has been really great way for me, since I don't normally have a crow audience at all, to share my work, and I haven't gotten any pushback from it. Is there any other question? Oh, there's one right here.
Getting my exercise.
Hi.
Hi.
I was curious, when you talked about your horseback riding and how much it is a part of you, and I grew up with horses and I can understand that so much, but I'm really curious how you chose dressage, because I think of it as such an incredibly, not tedious, but intensely not free running through the flowers and the
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering how you chose to do that.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question, and it's totally weird that I ended up doing dressage. It's kind of a long story, but so all Crow men want their daughters to be barrel racers. So I did that, and I hated it, and I fell down quite a bit with me and my horse. But I loved riding horses, and my dad raised alfalfa, and so he had people come to the ranch and get alfalfa, and this one guy saw me riding bareback chasing all the horses. And he said to my dad, well, she can do that. She could probably ride English. And my dad said, well, she's never even seen an English saddle. And my dad ended up taking me to that guy's ranch. And it turned out he was he raised Arabian horses. And so I rode equitation saddle seat first. And I don't know if you guys know that, but you wear top hats and things like that. So I was really actually into that, just wearing top hats. But I rode these stallions, and I used to have to get a waiver because I was like 11, and you have to be an adult to ride stallions. And then that horse ended up breaking his leg. And I was still really into riding English. Somehow somebody said, well, why don't you take lessons from this lady? And she did dressage. And so I had a Mustang from the Priors, wild horses from the Priors. And I trained him, and we did really well. And I ended up winning the regionals in first level or something. But then I used to train each summer in Colorado and ride at these barns on these $50,000 horses, you know? It was an interesting world. So that's how I ended up doing dressage. Yeah. I think we can do one more question, and then anybody?
Oh. This is not as much fun in a way, but the marvelous wall as part of the exhibit upstairs. How did you do that? What is the way to get an image like that?
The large photo?
Yeah. The one that's the one outside you can kind of look at and see how that's installed. I have no idea how you install the wall upstairs.
This is actually the museum helped me with that, and they have they work with a company that prints the images out sort of like wallpaper, and that's how I got that up there. Yeah. It was awesome. And the map, if you're talking about the map, that was all done by hand. Yeah, with three other people. Yeah. Thank you very much. I'm going to have a solo show in July at Half Gallery, so I'll be around again. But thank you. Sorry.